Hello everyone and welcome to Platts Inside Conversation. Today we're talking about a very hot topic, the escalating trade war between the US and China and the influence that it is having on the container market. President Trump is about to slap 25% tariffs on $200 billion worth of Chinese goods, many of which are transported in containers. So there are some serious concerns about the impact that it might have on the trade flows, freight, and all the players involved. At the same time, we have the IMO global sulfur cap of 2020, which is quickly approaching, which also makes the market increasingly nervous. To discuss these issues in more detail, I am joined today by Peter Sand, who is the Chief Shipping Analyst at BIMCO. Hello, Peter, and thanks for joining us today.
Hi, Alex. Thanks for having me.
Well, we have this trade war going on between the US and its trade partners, most notably China, and it has been escalating recently. There is a plan to impose another tranche of tariffs on $200 billion worth of Chinese goods, which in Trump's own words might take place very soon, right? And at the same time, there is another plan for $267 billion worth of tariffs. And we already have $50 billion in place. And China has been escalating in kind as well. So considering all those big numbers and tariffs imposed on them, how much of the influence has it had on the container market? And what should we expect going forward?
This whole trade war is a negative for shipping. I tend to say that shipping is right in the eye of the hurricane. What we have seen so far in terms of impact into it to the shipping industry is more of uncertainty than actual impact on volumes traded. But we have certainly seen that the retaliations and the escalation that we have seen in terms of the trade war right now is a negative to globalization, it's a negative to global economics, and it's a negative to shipping.
Okay, and so far, in terms of trade volumes, has it changed? Because the $50 billion tariffs on the $50 billion of goods, they have been mostly on the dry bulk, right? And a little less on containers. The next tranche might be a bit different. So in terms of how much the trade flows changed by now and how much they might change in the future with the new set of tariffs coming in, how much of a difference are we going to see there?
Right now, we have certainly seen an escalation of the war. Just later this September, we are absolutely sure that we're going to see the $200 billion list of tariffs coming into force from the U.S. And that is affecting the containerized trans-Pacific trade going into U.S. East Coast and U.S. West Coast enormously. We're actually looking into some 10% of all containerized goods going into the U.S. affected by this. In terms of dry bulk, of course, that is predominantly harmed and impacted by the Chinese goods. And the Chinese right now, with the latest escalation, they are about now to have a scope of 85% of all their seaborne imports from the US impacted by the trade war.
So in other words, it means that anytime a US retailer wants to stock up on things like vacuum cleaners, dolls, TVs, or whiskey tumblers, it will have to pay up and try to pass on those costs to their customers, which is a situation that every business probably wants to avoid. So how's the container market going to react to that? Are we going to have less volumes being shipped in containers between those countries? Or we're going to see other alternative routes maybe coming up in prominence?
At BIMCO Market Analysis Team, we have looked very carefully into those enormously long lists, and you wouldn't believe what you find there. You find like 460,000 sewing machines and 127 millions of lighting sets for Christmas trees. So it impacts everybody when a trade war like this is going on. And will the retailers of the U.S. Be able to pass on that extra cost to their consumers? I don't necessarily think so. All other things being equal, when a tariff is slammed on the price of a good, the price goes up. And consumers are likely to respond to that by consuming fewer of those goods. So all other things being equal, a price go up means that less cargoes get shipped, and that's the negative for the globalization and the negative for global shipping.
Right, and when we talk about demand, funny enough, every time when a US imposes tariffs, there is actually a surge in demand for both East Coast, North America, and West Coast, North America from China. Basically, shippers just try to transport their goods right before the deadline and avoid tariffs being slapped on them. But every time it's a very temporary development. So then we see the rates plateau, and our sources tell us that there is a very short window of opportunity. And after that surge of demand is down, there's nothing really to sustain freight rates. Do you agree with that? Once the surge in demand of the next tranche of tariffs passes, is the container market strong enough to maintain higher freight rates?
I think it's fair to say that that we have seen a pre-tariff rush of cargoes coming from the Far East, predominantly, of course, China, into the US. We've seen very healthy volumes coming into the US East Coast, up more than 7% in the first half, and also the West Coast up some 3.3% in the first 7 months. That has, in combination with a healthy deployment of ships from the shipping industry, meant that we are actually now seeing spot rates on the trade lanes from Shanghai into both East and West Coast of US at a 4 or 5 year high right now. So it has certainly have a positive impact on freight rates so far. On the other side of the peak season, which we are in the middle of right now, it's likely to have some kind of a payback in terms of goods being pushed forward, being stocked up, of course, needs to get consumed at the end. So what we expect in the near and middle term future for, say, the coming 3, 6, 9 months is that we're going to see seasonally lower volumes, but also lower volumes a bit lower than what a normal season would predict.
And certainly it's not just the trade war, which is the challenge for the container market. There is another big factor, which is the IMO sulfur cap of 2020. And the deadline for it is obviously quite quickly approaching now. And just as any other shipping market, the container market is now faced with quite a few tough choices. Carriers will have to either go down the way of using more expensive but cleaner fuels, like 0.5% fuel blends, or MGO, or invest in things like scrubbers or LNG-powered vessels. Each one of those options is quite uncertain. So my question is the container industry actually prepared for the challenges of IMO 2020 or not?
I would love to say yes. Next question, please. But I would rather pose the question back to you. Is the refinery industry ready for IMO 2020? And I would say, well, they are ready to cash in on the container shipping industry and the wider shipping industry's need for compliant fuel come January 1st, 2020, because it is very likely to see a spike in demand for compliant fuel, be it marine gas oil or low sulfur fuel oil. But the industry as such has not really picked up on investment in scrubbers, allowing them still to burn heavy sulfur fuel oil. It is pretty sure that that if you had the money and you invested in a scrubber, you would at least handle your risks and also get a decent payback within, say, 12, 36 months. It doesn't really matter because the payback will be there. But the real question is, do I have the money to invest? And I think that's the one thing that we're missing in the shipping industry right now.
And actually, when we talk about higher costs, another important question comes in. Who is actually going to be covering them? Because we already have seen bunker prices coming up this year, along with the oil prices. And that has already created quite a bit of friction between carriers and their customers when negotiating things like bunker adjustment factor, or how much are the costs in bunkers per shipping one container. And as we often see, the prices of bunkers per container don't move in line with the overall freight, which means that often either one side or another is losing money. And once we have higher bunker volatility, higher bunker costs, the stakes are higher. Many believe, which is going to happen during the IMO 2020, is going to make the situation even worse. So do you agree with that? And who would you expect to be absorbing those extra costs in bunkers?
I think what we are about to face January 2020 is an escalation of bunker fuel costs. Who's going to pay for that? Well, a part of the shipping industry believes that the customers is going to pay for that. And they also believe in the same way that it will be easy peasy to simply have a new bunker adjustment factor, the SQL or something like that, attached to every box that is shipped. But it all comes down to the negotiation power between the liner companies and the shippers, because the cost of fuel has also become a part of the negotiations every time around. You go into either the contract market or the spot market. It is a part of the, say, all-inclusive freight costs. And it comes back to the fundamental balance of the market then, because if you are in a market where there's too much capacity fighting for the cargoes, you cannot pass on that extra cost. That's why we tend to see this as a risk management thing, because the container shipping industry is running a market of overcapacity.
And since you now mentioned oversupply, the connection between the supply and the negotiating power is quite obvious in shipping. And the oversupply has been a problem for pretty much every shipping market for a long time. But now that we have these challenges of the trade war, of IMO 2020 and bunker price volatility, are we going to have also the oversupply come 2020 in the container market?
I think we are going to see oversupply in the container shipping market come 2020 and 2021 again. The shipping industry, container shipping industry, has certainly learned a lot from the past couple of years where they have really struggled generating a decent profit in a market with huge overcapacity. But it's unlikely to be turning tables next month or next year, where we're going to see a much improved market. Putting things into perspective, a decade ago we had a trade multiplier of 2, where whenever economic growth was generated somewhere in the world, it meant a doubling in terms of cargo shipped, particularly for container shipping. That multiplier has now come down to 1, meaning that also whenever, say, mistakes in the container shipping industry in terms of ordering too much ahead of demand growth, you had a year or 2, and then that mistake was once again back leveled, simply due to the multiplier constantly helping you adjust the differences. Right now, with a multiplier of only 1, we tend to see much smaller movements in favor of improved fundamentals or against improved fundamentals. When we started 2018, it looks as if the container shipping industry were heading for a improvement of the fundamental market balance. In our most recent report that was just out a week ago, we see it obviously the other way around now, simply due to the fact that global demand is only growing 3.8%. We expected 4 to 5%, and the fleet is growing stronger than that. It's already growing, I think, in excess of 4%, mainly due to demolition coming to an almost complete stop. So it still remains in the hands of the industry, in terms of the ship owners, to handle the oversupply.
And do you see them already doing that, being cautious at the moment when they look about all the risk factors that we talked about, and they look at oversupply and they're like, maybe I should hold off from ordering new tonnage, especially big, massive ships, which we have been seeing delivered recently, and just maybe take a more cautious approach and see what happens with those risk factors? Or the industry is not in that mindset yet?
I'm the first to admit that it's dead easy to tell the industry what it should do and what it shouldn't do, as long as I'm not the one investing $4 billion in a completely new fleet and asking them to get rid of all the say the excess capacity, because in the minds of every ship owner there are no excess capacity. At least I do not have excess capacity. So if you go out and scrap your excess capacity, we will all have a better market. And I think that comes down to the essence of the responsibility of the bigger companies in order to balance out the market. Because right or wrong, whenever they go out and scrap a certain share of their fleet, it's not as if they are cutting like 50% of their entire capacity, as opposed to perhaps a smaller owner. This predominantly goes for the tramp shipping sectors, but also in terms of container shipping, where we have seen absolutely no demolition this year at all.
Okay, so in other words, we have the bunker price volatility, trade wars, which are probably gonna last, or at least the effects of them gonna last for a while, and potentially the oversupply. So is there any, you know, light at the end of the tunnel for the container carriers?
I think there is not just a flashing flashlight at the end of the tunnel, and it's not a train approaching fast. But I think it's fair to say that the overall trade war right now is a speeding train growing in the wrong direction. It is likely to reduce at least the way we see it, this is not going to go away tomorrow. So it is likely to have a negative impact on global economic growth and globalization, and then of course also on shipping. So what we need to be focusing on is that shipping is doing something good for the entire globe as such. It is also constantly growing, regardless of poor freight rates and perhaps bad management in terms of the whole industry, balancing out supply and demand. But it is constantly growing in tandem with global growth. So it remains a matter of balancing out the supply with the demand, and then weather it out in the end. At least it's going to be volatile in many ways, what will happen come January 1st, 2020.
Understood. Well, thanks a lot for sharing your insights with us, Peter.
It's a pleasure.
And we here at Platts invite everyone with exposure to container freight to register for Platts Web Container App using the link in the description. There you can also find the link to our latest special report, which explores the challenges of managing bunker costs in the container market. And this concludes today's Insight video. See you next time.